So good evening, everyone. Yet another online FOF, unfortunately. Really hope that it starts soon and we can meet in person again. But today, despite all the headlines and all sorts of negative sentiment, the topic which is far more interesting than the news items is what Rajeev is going to discuss today. You must have received a glimpse in the email, but I think it will be much better if Rajeev takes over and walks us through. Rajeev, over to you, please.
Thanks, Ronak. So, just before we started the formal part of the session today, Mehul was mentioning that people will be thinking only about Russia and Ukraine and who will be interested in the talk. So, the good part is that just before we commenced, I was getting some forwards on WhatsApp, which were talking about how much some of these stocks are down from the listing price. And it's topical in a different kind of way. The main headline, of course, remains Russia and Ukraine and NATO and all those kind of things. But the question is that are these investable somewhere? Obviously, the stocks are, some of them are down significantly from the IPO price. So do these make attractive investments, or should one actually sell out of these even at a loss, or what should we do with some of these companies? And again, the past experience is not much of a guide, because as most of you know, that many of these companies don't report profits for now, and people are confused as to how to really go about valuing these. So I will not be giving any stock-specific recommendations, meaning should you buy Zomato or hold or sell, meaning that is, of course, for you to decide. But we will be looking at some of the frameworks as to how to actually go about thinking about these businesses and how to arrive at some decision. So let's dive right into it. I don't need to tell you this. It's been very, very brutal, and some of the charts that you will see will not capture today's fall, or all of them will not capture today's fall. These charts are beginning of the week or end of last week. So again, prices would have come down further. So whether it's Paytm or 197 Communications Limited, whether it's Zomato, whether it's Nykaa, Policy Bazaar, Car Trade, so all of these are significantly down from listing. And this is not restricted to India. So people who have been tracking the tech space or the innovative company space, whether it be in the US or whether it be in China, China has been very, very brutal, not just because of the overall sell-off, but also because of some of the policy actions that are happening over there. So the star fund of the post-COVID era, the ARK Innovation ETF, where the fund manager, the lady is well known, Cathie Wood. So that also is down very, very significantly. So 160 odd to 63. And this again is a few days old. So current price will be even lower, significantly lower. So this is what has been happening. So the question comes that, is this a tech sell-off? So is this a sector-specific sell-off? So it looks like it. So given that a lot of the technology names are down, it looks like a tech sell-off. But I would answer this in two ways. I'll say it is a tech sell-off. At the same time, it's actually not a tech sell-off. Reason being, if you look at HCL Tech or something like that, again, a few days old chart, but it's off from the peaks, but nowhere like the ARK Innovation ETF or some of the newly listed companies. Alphabet and Microsoft and Amazon and all are down, but it's not that they've lost half the value or they are down some 70-80% or anything like that. So these are the big ups and downs that happen in these kind of stocks. And we have seen those kind of things happen in the past as well. So if you look at the earlier history, for example, in September of 2020, for example, that there was no specific COVID kind of thing. We were well into the COVID period. But that time also in September 2020, we saw a big fall. And again in 21, we saw a fall somewhere. So this is one among those kind of falls. Whereas some of the frothier names have had very, very big corrections. So it's in technology sector, but I would say that it's in companies where there has been a lot of storytelling and where the current cash flows are not positive and there is a lot of cash burn in some of these companies. Those are the companies which have been majorly affected. So ignore the market cap numbers. Obviously, they are further down, but these are in tens of thousands of crores in terms of market cap. So these are not tiny companies in terms of the market capitalization. At the same time, a lot of them are burning cash. Some are reporting break even, but not too much of profit. So this is where we stand today. Now, this is almost like religion, or this is almost like someone who believes in God and someone who's an atheist. People scream at each other and they think that their point of view is the correct point of view and the other person is completely wrong. And no conversation happens. People just scream at each other. This is something similar to what is happening in the startup place or in the newly listed companies. There are a set of believers. There are some investors, some analysts who think that these are great companies. They will change the way we do business or we live our daily lives. And these can create very significant value in the coming years. And one should ignore the current reported numbers, because in the early days, even Amazon was running at a loss or not reporting very great profitable numbers. Or that's the nature of the startup space, where initially you don't have profits. That is one camp. And the other camp thinks that, oh, we have seen this before, frothy sector, bubble, governance is not good, so much of cash burn rate, and they're just subsidizing users and there's no business case. So today we will try and have a conversation rather than just screaming at one another. And in the conversation, we look at the arguments made by both sides rather than looking at only one side. Before we get into the specific points, in the earlier days, things were cut and dried. So whenever some smart person had a interesting idea, that person would approach family, friends, or would have her or his own savings to start a business. Or someone would approach people called angel investors. These angel investors are people who, based on the capability of a person, based on the strength of the idea, and just as a leap of faith, write out a small check to get the ball rolling. So these are the angel investors, where the business plan may not have crystallized, where the product name may not be there, where the founding team may not be fully complete, only a few members are on board yet. So that would get the ball rolling. Then once the initial team is there with the angel funding in place, people would go about completing the rudimentary founding team. They would have a business plan, they would have a product prototype maybe, and there would be various rounds of venture capital funding. Once a company reached a particular stage, once it was certain that the company is going to survive and it will be prosperous, you will have later stage investors coming in, people who are typically referred to as private equity players. And then once the business achieved a scale where they can manage the complexity of life as a listed company with all the attendant regulations and regulatory costs and transparency and all that, then the company would come out with the IPO, and then there would be a mature stage. This used to be cut and dried earlier. However, we saw this changing in the US markets first, where the likes of Uber, etc., where they had no profits or they were still burning cash, they came for a listing and they became public market companies. So, public market investors effectively became venture capitalists in that sense. And in India, we have now seen that happening with the listings of the likes of Paytm and Zomato and so on. So things have gotten a bit fuzzy here. There are two schools of thought over here as to actually how to value these companies. Normally, people look at price to earning ratios, dividend yield, price to free cash flow, or someone who would do a discounted cash flow analysis, all of that. Whereas other people say that all these tools are useless for a new company because the future will be very, very different. Don't use any of those and use some other metrics. So what is the current way of valuing these companies? There are positives and negatives to both. We will take a look at those. But one thing to keep in mind before we dive into it, just there are positives and negatives for both the methods of valuation. One is using the traditional DCF analysis or based on earnings, etc., and making projections far out in the future. The other is looking at some other metrics which typically are used in the VC world. We will look at what those are as we go along. And the reason to consider these companies is that, as we have seen, that these are already valued at tens of thousands of crores in the marketplace. So if they don't work out, then a lot of shareholders will lose a lot of their existing wealth. And at the same time, if they work out and if they end up disrupting some of the existing incumbents and they become very, very big companies, then by not tracking them or by not buying them, arguably there may be an opportunity loss for people who don't buy the companies. So a lot of wealth will probably be created and destroyed. I'm not saying or, because when you have tens and hundreds of companies, some of them will become great wealth creators and some of them will destroy a lot of wealth. So it's important to distinguish one from the other. So let's look at the positive camp first. Who are the people who are bullish on these loss-making companies and these cash-burn companies? So firstly, get this thing out of your head completely. If you are a naysayer, if you are bearish on these companies, get this one thing in your mind, that not all loss is bad. There are many losses which are actually good for shareholders. And this is not a new concept that I'm floating today. This is a concept that has been around for many, many decades. And I'll demonstrate that. Yeah. So, almost 23 years back, Warren Buffett wrote about Geico to shareholders. And Tom Russo also talks about this in terms of capacity to suffer. So there was this situation about this car insurance company or insurance company Geico, where they sell car insurance to various people. Now, to acquire a new customer, you have to have advertising, you have to have sales agents, call centers, printing costs, mailing costs, various costs are there in terms of onboarding a new customer. And as per their calculation, in the year that they signed up a new customer, that new customer would result in a $250 loss for Geico, one customer. So if you had 10 additional customers, $2,500 would be the loss. And if you had 1,000 customers, then $250,000 loss. So obviously, if you signed millions of customers, then you would have losses in hundreds of millions for the company and for Berkshire. Now, any listed company, if they are going to lose a lot of money, then shareholders will start to question, and sometimes the CEO may get fired and things like that. But Warren Buffett, since it owned Geico and they said, oh, we have capacity to bear this loss, as long as it's wealth creating for shareholders. So what they calculated is that this client, who in year one results in a loss of $250, from year two onwards generates a profit of $150 each year. So for a one-time loss of $250, you get a $150 annuity for many, many years. So obviously, on a net basis, it's a positive outcome. So Buffett told the CEO, don't worry about the reported earnings and don't worry about the near-term impact on P&L. Just go and get more customers, as long as it's good quality customers that we are getting. So the concept is not new. Concept has been around forever. Today, when all these companies are talking about things like CAC and TAM and LTV and all that, all this jargon sounds something that has been thought about in the last 3, 4, 5 years or 10 years. Answer is no. It has been around for a very, very long time. So what is CAC? CAC is nothing but cost of acquiring a customer. Sometimes people refer to funnel and all that, but which is a traditional advertising metric. It's as simple as it sounds, cost of acquiring a customer. So you may have an advertising budget. Let's say you spend 1,000 rupees, 100 people see your ad. So then cost of reaching each customer is 10 rupees. Now out of those 100, 10 may indicate some interest in your product, in which case cost of a lead is 100 rupees. Out of those 10 who show interest in your product, maybe only one signs up for your product, in which case your cost of acquiring one customer is 1000 rupees. So relatively simpler to calculate. The second part is where the storytelling comes in. Like in the case of Geico, Buffett said that cost of acquiring a customer first year and the loss associated with it was $250 per customer. Lifetime value, as per Berkshire's estimate and all that, was $150 positive per year. So you take across the life of a customer with Geico and you discount that to the present value, that would be the lifetime value. Now here is where some amount of fuzziness comes in. If you are spending 1000 rupees on acquiring a customer, will that customer be there with you for just this one transaction? Will that customer be there with you for 1 year, 5 years, 10 years? That's fuzzy, right? You don't know. So when Uber, let's say, gives 3 free rides for every new customer signing up, now that's an upfront cost because they will have to pay to the driver of the car. But the customer will get it for free, in which case you know the cost of acquiring a customer. But what if the customer just takes the free rides and never then returns to the platform? Then there is no lifetime value. On the other hand, if the customer is with you for 10 years and gives up a personal vehicle and only uses Uber for commuting for work and for leisure and all that, then obviously lifetime value is great. So this is where the fuzziness part comes in. And here, some amount of judgment is required. If you can clearly see that the cost of acquisition is one time and you are going to see actually a lifetime value, then go ahead and buy the loss-making company. But if you think that the moment the company stops cash burn, all the customers will run to the exit doors, then obviously you should also run to the exit door as far as the shares of the company are concerned. The other thing that people point out, the proponents of some of these companies, is that a lot of these companies are fixed cost businesses. So for example, if you are creating something like a Uber, a lot of the costs that you incur initially will be in terms of creating the technology platform, in terms of the app and all of that, in terms of onboarding the drivers, getting the customers, all of that. Initially, the cost is high. But if you are just servicing 100 customers, the cost per customer will be very, very large. But as more and more customers start using that technology platform, let's say if a million customers use your platform, then the cost per customer comes down dramatically. So nothing technical about it. Operating leverage is just that as more and more customers come to you, your fixed costs will get divided over more number of customers. So that your per customer cost will be small, or your per transaction cost will be small. Think about it in another manner. Let's say a stock broker. The cost of acquiring a NSE membership, buying the computers, setting up a lease line to the exchange, all of these are fixed costs. Now, if you are serving just one customer, then your per customer cost is very, very high. But if you have many, many customers who are trading very frequently with you, you can operate profitably. This is another area where either things can be like lottery tickets and can pay off in a big way, or sometimes it may just be storytelling and you may end up with very, very fancy losses. So this is TAM, or the full form is total addressable market. Now here you can make all sorts of assumptions. So what is the total addressable market for Uber, Ola, Paytm, Swiggy, Zomato? Who knows? So at the extreme, you can people say, oh, India is a country of this much population and this much percentage of population will start using our services and they will order these many times a month and all that. At the other end, you'll have the existing customer base, which will be much smaller. And when you drill down, not too many people will have credit cards, or smartphone population will be only a subsegment of the entire population and all of that. So some amount of judgment and care is required when you are doing total addressable market analysis. The other thing people talk about is, oh, Amazon started as just a bookseller. You can't value Amazon as a bookseller. You have to see in the future what all other things they'll do. So from bookseller, they became a seller of music and toys and all of the other things. Then they became the everything store. Then they started cloud computing services, then advertising, and then logistics and whatnot. So people can get into adjacent areas. Google was a search engine at one time. Then it became YouTube. They acquired YouTube and they became a streaming media company. So don't just look at what the company is today. Use your imagination. Think about what can happen in the future. So that is the bull case that is made out for some of these companies. And there's a wonderful book called Blitzscaling, where in areas where either it's a monopoly or a duopoly, it makes sense to burn a lot of cash upfront rather than be conservative in spending cash. Because if it's a winner-takes-all kind of market, then the first person to win or to reach somewhere will take the entire profits and the remaining people will get wiped out. So Professor Sahasrabuddha would say in the movie Three Idiots, who was the first person to step on the moon? And people remember the first person and no one thinks about the second person. So just like that, if you are a Uber or if you are a Airbnb, then you want to be either the number one or number two. You don't want to be lower down the rank, because then no one would come to you. And further, optionalities are very similar to adjacencies, but sometimes these can be very, very far off things. So in Google, arguably you can say that YouTube and Gmail and photos and all that is linked to their IT services, but then they will get into life sciences and things like that. Or ride sharing company like Ola will get into electric vehicles or something else. So if you are participating in some of these innovative companies and where the management depth is strong and they have great ideas and things like that, they can scale up in various areas and not just in the business they are doing currently. So all that is the positive spin that gets thrown around, and that's the reason why they managed to get such a listing. But at the other end, one has to be careful. So what are the negatives that are there, and what is the bear case for some of these companies? So firstly, you have to think in terms of base rates. I think this is where most people get it wrong. When people talk about Amazon, which was break-even or loss-making for many, many years, and now has succeeded beyond imagination, people forget about so many other companies that were loss-making and that got wiped out. So it's not that you have hundreds and thousands of Amazons. You have one Amazon. So the probability of a company which is continuously burning cash or continuously making losses, probability of that company becoming very, very big is not that high. It's a low rate. And the venture capitalists are well aware of this fact. So what they do is that they spread out their investments over many, many companies. So out of hundreds of companies that early stage VCs will fund, many will go bankrupt and only a handful will probably succeed in a big way and will give them decent return on a portfolio basis. But individual companies can lose all the money that has been put in. So that is something that one has to keep in mind. Just to give an analogy, a profit-making, free cash flow generating company listed on the market, a mature company, is like a train where the tracks are laid out, where the route is known and is going along. You can predict what the future will look like. Or it can be a bus or a car or a truck going on the national highway from city A to city B. Whereas the early stage companies are going in, let's say, a forest where you don't know what you will find, where there's no pakka road, where they are beating their own path. They may find a pot of gold or they may come across a snake or a lion. You don't know what will happen. So both are very, very different things. Just because a Paytm is listed on BSE NSE and a HDFC bank is listed on a BSE NSE, you can't compare the risk and return of both these companies. One is a very different company from the other company. So when you are investing in companies with low base rates of success, by definition, your portfolio allocation to such companies should be lower. So normally for mature companies, it is said that if you have anywhere between 15, 20, 25 companies, you get most of the benefits of diversification. So let us say if you own 20 mature listed companies, large cap companies, on an average, your weightage per company will be, let's say, 5%. 5% in each stock, 20 stocks. So 100% of your equity portfolio is invested there. But can you do the same with 20 startups? Answer is no. You cannot put 5% of your portfolio in one startup and hope to make it big. What if all 20 of these startups go bankrupt? Then you lose all your money. So if you are investing in companies with low probability of success, then you have to put very, very small amounts where if you lose the money, you will not be pinched so much. And if the company succeeds, then if you have invested one, then that one will grow to 5, 10, 15, 20. You don't know the upside. Maybe the upside can be very, very large. So that's the way to look at investing in this space. So you have to be mindful of base rates, and you have to also be mindful of competition. So whenever something is promising, a lot of people come into that space and try and compete away. So if you look at app-based grocery delivery, you'll have tens and maybe hundreds of companies trying to compete and trying to give you the fastest delivery for your grocery order. What happens when there's too much competition? When there's too much competition, losses increase. So be mindful of the fact that there will be competition, and it's not guaranteed that the company you are investing in is going to succeed. So in the fintech space, for example, it's not that you just have one Paytm. You'll have one Paytm, Bharat Pay, Phone Pay, Google Pay, Jio Pay, WhatsApp Pay. Each bank will have its UPI thing. You'll have NBFCs like Bajaj Finance and all that. So there will be plenty of competition in each of these areas. So sometimes our minds play tricks on us, and we tend to think that anything which for which we create an app and we add a payment mechanism will go out and disrupt the way things are currently happening. But that is not the way the world works. Some of the activities are very amenable to disruption by technology, and some of the things are not. So it's important to distinguish between the two. So just for example, books, which was the first category that Amazon entered, the number of books world over is very, very large. And no matter how big a cornerstone the street corner bookstore is, it will not be able to serve the needs of a voracious reader. So books is a category where it was relatively easy to disrupt, because you have a central warehouse somewhere and you can ship the books, and the book will reach the person in 1 or 2 days, and they won't mind waiting because the variety that they get online is much more than what they can get in their physical bookstores, which is near their house. So that was easy to disrupt. But grocery, if you are hungry right now, typically you want that soft drink, or you want that pack of biscuit or noodles or something. You want that quickly. And the variety is not as big as, let's say, the number of books in publication. So grocery is tougher to disrupt than something like a books category. So one has to arrive at a judgment as to whether this business will succeed in the app and digital format or whether it will not. And clearly what is happening over the past few months is that inflation is rising the world over. The era of tightening of interest rates is here. So in the days of easy money and negative interest rates and all that, it was very, very easy for startups to get funding. Now the question is whether some of these companies can survive without getting external funding. That will be one of the key metrics on which to evaluate some of these listed companies. Because if they are continuously dependent on kindness of strangers, where just to pay the next month's salary, if you are waiting for SoftBank to write you a check, then obviously things will be very difficult as time goes by. The other question to evaluate is, don't look at the current customer base. Look at what will happen when the subsidy goes away. And moving away a little bit from the startup phase, let's look at the telecom sector, for example. In the past 10, 15, 20 years, many people have come in with low pricing and they got subscribers. And then when they increase the prices, the customers go away. With entry of Jio, everyone started to reduce prices for data and for the monthly ARPUs. So Vodafone Idea, Airtel, Jio all cut their prices. So when prices were very, very low, people had multiple SIMs in their phone. So everyone had minimum of 2 SIMs in their phone. Now, last few months, as prices have started going up, we are seeing suddenly that people are saying, oh, I can manage with 1 SIM, why keep 2 SIMs? So gradually you are seeing some amount of subscriber churn. So similar thing happens. So don't assume that the volume growth that is there or what you are seeing in terms of number of customers, when there is a subsidy to the customer, that will remain the same way when you eventually remove the subsidy. So that is another key question to ask. And finally, don't ignore the incumbents. So the competition for Zomato is not just Swiggy. So competition to Zomato and Swiggy both will be the neighborhood restaurant who takes order on the phone and has delivery boys. It could be the pizza companies, or it could be the burger companies. So Domino's or McDonald's and all these, anyone who has a delivery thing eventually becomes a competition. And finally, right now they may be either subsidizing the customer or not charging too much from the restaurants. But if the charge becomes too much, where they start making a lot of profits, then the restaurants may figure out that instead of relying on these guys, why don't we create our own delivery mechanism? So don't ignore the incumbents when you are looking at the disruptors and when you are looking at the newer age companies. So just for fun, plotted some market caps and some other traditional incumbents. So yeah, sometimes you get traditional companies at far more attractive valuations, and where you clearly see cash flows coming in, and some of these will actually be also innovating in the app space or delivery space or fintech or what have you. So don't ignore the incumbents when you are getting excited by the new age listings. So Benjamin Graham had said this many decades ago. I'll read this out. Obvious prospects for physical growth in a business do not translate into obvious profits for investors. So we have seen this in telecom, we have seen this in airlines, we may see it in the startup space. So just because you see a lot of people wearing t-shirts and racing on bikes out to deliver something or the other, doesn't mean that those businesses will result in profits for investors. So that's a different evaluation, and you have to come to your own conclusion. Again, the objective today is not to run these companies down. A lot of these companies have created employment opportunities for people which were not there earlier. A lot of these companies have helped merchants, have helped restaurants to grow their business. A lot of consumers are very happy with some of the services that are being provided. What we can hope is that the shareholders will also be happy, just like employees or restaurants or merchants are happy or customers are happy. So that evaluation we have to make, and only when all boxes are ticked, where you are confident that the company will survive, number one, will not need continuous external funding, then you can confidently invest in these kind of companies. So that's what I wanted to share today, and happy to take questions or comments and interact with people. Hopefully this will be the last virtual FOF that we have, and we'll be back at CCI soon, because obviously this is not the best system to have interaction, but nevertheless, thank you very much.
Thanks, Rajeev. What a wonderful presentation. I think one interesting thing about these companies now getting listed are the data is available for us to track and build a model or some kind of prediction. If the companies were not listed, then all the data would reside only as a private investor slide. And as analysts, we won't have a chance to study these companies. I'll request, I think, Malhar has a question. Malhar, please go ahead. You can unmute yourself and ask. And anybody else also later, if they have a question, please ask by unmuting yourself. Thank you. Yes, please, Malhar.
Okay. So good evening, first of all. And Rajeev, sir, thank you for the wonderful presentation, as always. So I have a couple of questions, actually. Firstly, we have seen that with these companies raising so much equity from investors, the stake of the original founder has gotten diluted enormously. So is there really enough skin in the game for the founders to continue and build the business and so forth?
That's a very interesting point that you are making. And I think this can be one of the criteria. So the successful names that typically one sees or one talks about, let's say Google, for example, where Larry and Sergey had big stakes in the company and they were tied to the well-being of the company. Jeff Bezos in terms of Amazon, Mark Zuckerberg in terms of Facebook, or whether you are a fan or a critic of Tesla, but Elon Musk is as tied as fortunes to the well-being of the company. Of course, he sold some stock recently, but he has big stakes, whereas some of the companies that one hears about where people have very, very limited stakes in the company and most of their income and wealth comes from the paycheck that they get from the company. And they are interested in taking cash out of the company as soon as possible by various means so that their well-being is not affected and then they don't care what happens to the company. So that is an important thing to look out for as to what is the stake of the founding team and the core management team.
Ajay, one more question linked to dilution. Because it is relevant, I'll ask here. This is a question from Vivek. And he's asking that, what about the overall dilution at the end of the fundraising cycle? Like, how do we know how much shares are going to be there in the market outstanding? And how do you really value based on a per share basis in that context? Because there are several examples where dilutions have been continuous and they continue to happen because fundraising doesn't stop even after listing.
True. So there's no clear answer for this. So as I said, give an analogy, this is akin to going into the forest and with some compass which gives you a vague sense of direction, whether you are going in north or south or west or east, and some printed map that you may have in your pocket, which gives you broadly some vague idea of the terrain. So you don't know what products, markets, geographies they'll enter into, how much money they will require, how much will be the future share capital. If it's very early stage, sometimes it's just a leap of faith. Many a times it's just looking at the idea, the founding team, alignment of interests, and thinking that it will work out well. The kind of investing that we do at PPFS, we are looking at more mature companies where the dilution is not that big a issue. But in the initial stages, a lot of it is fuzzy. There are no clear answers many a times.
There's a question from Mehul Bhai. Please go ahead, Mehul sir.
So Rajeev, I think one thing is very clear that these startups have got a lot of free money, and we always talk about disruption in the business. Now, our biggest worry today remains that we invest in a business and which gets disrupted. And I'm specifically here now talking about the banking sector. So if you take, good private sector banks, HDFC or Kotak or Axis or any of these banks, and then you have these fellows like Paytm, then you have peer-to-peer lending, who seem to have unlimited funds from venture capitalists or Blackstone or all these people. Since you're also from the banking field, do you see a fear whereby these fellows are likely to disrupt these banks, or are we safe at least for another 5 or 6 years?
I am very, very positive in the banking space on the incumbents as compared to the disruptors. So that is one space where I think that the incumbents have a big advantage. If one looks at it, most of the disruptors, so-called disruptors, try and compete on the lending side, where they get startup money or where they raise some wholesale funding and try and compete in terms of lending with other people. Almost all of them don't have access to low-cost deposits, whereas the incumbents, especially in the banking space, have the low-cost current account, saving account balances. So, on the liability side, it's a question of reputation, trust, ownership, all of that. So, the newer players have had a tough time generating low-cost lending resources. That is one. Secondly, most of the banks already have a relationship where someone may have a business account or someone may have a professional account or a salary account where their income comes in and where the bankers are able to have a judgment on how much to lend, in what manner to lend, and to also undertake recovery processes. Now, fintech is fine for the transaction of lending, but when it comes to actually recovering money in case someone defaults, that's where the trouble starts, or in terms of creating a proper asset liability management. I don't think you have too many examples, at least in the Indian context and probably even globally, where people started off as tech companies and really did something very big or dramatic in the financial services place. So, of course, you have stockbrokers and the like, which is only intermediation. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about hardcore lending where your balance sheet is at risk. So, over there, mostly it has been the existing players who are agile in terms of improving customer design, customer interface, and all those kind of things, who have been winning the game, rather than pure tech companies with no finance experience, no feet on the street, no on-ground deposit franchise, or no on-ground infrastructure to recover money. The peer-to-peer lending that you referred to is easy to start. All it requires is some coding skills. But the experience in other markets and even in India has been that it goes south very, very soon, meaning as soon as the first round of defaults start happening is when people lose faith in the concept, and then it gets a very bad rep.
Thank you.
Rajeev, one interesting question in the chat, and Rushir, I'll come to you in a bit. So the question is, how do we value the optionalities? So every company cannot assume to find optionality like Amazon did with AWS or some other businesses. So how do we account for that when we are looking at these companies?
My preferred way is to give zero value to optionality. That should be a free lottery ticket that comes to you. And the existing business should have enough cash flow to justify the valuation on its own rather than paying for the optionality. If there are plenty of optionalities, then maybe you can give some small value to it, but essentially it should come free to you. The upside should be free, and the downside should be protected by the cash flow generation that the mature part of the business gets.
Rushil, please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. My question is that since we have been seeing that most of the new age companies, you know, have been scaling up their core business, which they are into. But apart from it, we are seeing them, you know, they are investing into other ancillaries, which they say that, you know, it might help the create an ecosystem or it might help to their core business. But are those signs are clearly signs of missed capital allocation? Because what we are seeing that, you know, either it's a bit confusing to see that either they are really creating an ecosystem or they are acting like a more of a venture capitalist fund.
That's a very interesting question, Rushil. So almost all successful companies with these adjacencies and pivots and all that I've seen are people who first conquered one market. They were very, very successful in one space where they had cash flow gushing out of that main business, and they used part of that cash flow to seed some other business. That other business succeeded, then they used that cash flow to seed a third business. I have yet to see very many examples where people kept raising money continuously in round one, round two, round three, and each quarterly results, they come out with a new story. Right now, we are doing ride hailing, then we'll do food delivery, then we'll do something else, e-commerce, then we'll do fintech, then we'll do insurance. So if they keep for changing the focus of the business area every 3 months, every 6 months, or if they are entering 20 sectors without succeeding in even one, then to me, it's a red flag. One should be away from such companies.
There's a question from Devesh. So it's a slightly broader question. I'm just reading it out. So how do you perceive the sudden change in the overall market structure of India? Are we getting ahead of ourselves because of the recent bull run and with the huge number of these loss-making startups becoming listed and attracting massive amounts of money? Also, what effect do you think this will have on the existing proven players who are being ignored by the investors lately?
So I don't think there's need to worry too much or be paranoid about these newer listings, because some of them will actually end up succeeding. So in some places, there's a natural tendency for only one or two players to survive, where there are double-sided network effects. We have spoken about this at length in various contexts. So logically, ride hailing should tend towards one or two players or things like that. Again, some of the arguments that people make seem logical, where instead of having a private vehicle, if you have ride hailing, then you can save on capital costs, you can save on parking spaces. Sharing a ride becomes easier, because if four people are going the same way in four vehicles, the technology can bring all four of them to one vehicle so that the costs are shared between those four and the road space is freed up to that extent. So there can be arguments for this. Food delivery maybe instead of standardized item like, let's say, a paratha or idli or something which is very staple and which is high volume thing, you can have cloud kitchens coming in and trying to optimize cost for the customer and benefiting the platform or whatever. So we have to see how these things pan out. I think in each market there will be a mix of mature businesses and new age businesses, and investors have to choose the segment where they find their competency and where they see opportunity and go and invest there. I don't see this as a negative where we allow companies to list in India before they are profitable. Of course, some amount of hype and there will be some losses that people will make. But I think once people go through a cycle, they will understand that investing in early stage companies is not everyone's cup of tea, and they should stick to what they know rather than become too adventurous.
Mallar, you have a question? Please go ahead.
Yes. So, sir, in your presentation, you mentioned about the lifetime value of customer is based on, you know, there can be storytelling by the company going on there. But I have been doing some reading and studying on this LTV to CAC. And I seem to understand that actually there is a quantitative formula to this also, where basically it is based on the average order value which the customer makes every time and the churn rate. For example, if the monthly churn rate of customers is 2%, then you invert that and you calculate that the customer will stay for 50 months. So if the churn rate is 4%, the customer will stay for 25 months in that manner. So I wanted your views on this, because you mentioned it is subjective and qualitative.
Yeah. So I have a counter question for you, Malhar. Is DCF a subjective exercise or is it an objective exercise? Discounted cash flow.
Yeah, that is a fair point, sir.
Yeah. So the formula is quantitative, the numbers, the inputs to that formula are things which are subjective. Okay, you can say that the last month's churn rate was 1% or 2% or whatever. What that churn rate will be in the future is difficult to say, and it's an assumption. That is one. Secondly, a lot of these metrics based on which we value these companies are not subject to standardization or are not subject to audit or external validation. In mature companies, sometimes frauds like Satyam or Enron do come about, but generally you are relatively sure of the cash balance that the company has or the free cash flow that was generated in a year and stuff like that. But in a company which is self-reporting churn numbers, now let us say, I'm not saying any of these companies do it, but let us say if I run a ride hailing company and I was giving 3 free rides and customers were signing up to my ride hailing app, and then 50% of them would churn away, right? Now that's a very bad metric to report in the quarterly numbers. So either I completely make up those churn numbers, or what I do is I game the metric. So if some people are not taking paid rides on my app, I again nudge them. The app is already installed on the phone. I send them a notification. Oh, you have not been on our app for some time, or you have not booked a ride. Here's a 300 rupee discount on your next ride. Why don't you book a ride? So you can try and juggle that around. Now, how reliable these are or how much in the future you can project them is something that I'm skeptical about.
So Kirit Bhai, who asked the optionality question earlier, there's a very specific question regarding a portfolio company of ours. I don't know if we can answer that. He's saying that going by that logic of optionality, the current price of Facebook seems to be backed by predictable cash flows. Would you say that in such cases, one is getting optionality relating to the metaverse as a free call option?
So none of the call options are free, because the company is going to spend billions of dollars pursuing the metaverse. Will that turn out to be great? Will that turn out to be a dud? We don't have an answer today. Only time will tell. One difference that we see in something like Meta or Facebook is that the amount of spending, investment, whatever you want to call on the metaverse, is relatively larger to what other companies have done in the past. So Alphabet, Google has been doing these side projects, but they don't put all their profits into the side project. Whereas this one, I think a big chunk of their 1 year or maybe even 2 years cash flow will go into this thing. So yeah, we'll see how that works out. I don't have a strong view one way or the other as to how the metaverse thing will play out.
Mallar, you have a question, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. So also I wanted some book recommendations. You mentioned blitz scaling, but other than that, if you could share maybe 3, 4, 5 books, not only on this topic, but even generally.
Okay, so there are some wonderful blogs that Ronak had shared with me. So maybe we'll put those links in the comment section of the YouTube video when it comes out. So people have spoken about how actually investments happen in VCs and stuff like that. So people who don't work in the VC space have a certain idea as to how things would be happening there, whereas the actual way things work is very, very different. So we'll try and put some of those links in.
So Mallar, just to give you a quick answer, there's a new book which was written by an author called Sebastian Mallaby called The Power Law. and it talks about the history of several deals and several well-known VCs and how these partners have sourced deals and invested in them over the past few decades. So you might want to check that out.
Yes, sir. So actually it is there in my Amazon shopping cart already. So hopefully in the next few days I'll order it.
Thank you. As an Amazon shareholder, thank you.
Sure. And also generally, apart from this topic, also any top book recommendations? Even Ronak, sir, you can also add.
I think go through my Twitter timeline. If you're not on Twitter, you should be there. A lot of people share wonderful things. So I keep sharing a lot of books there. So just to save time here.
I can't think of any one or two. I'll just pull up some my bookstore. Just one second. One book I read recently, nothing to do with investing. It's called The Order of Time. It's more on physics and stuff. As I've mentioned earlier, I've been reading on China. After that, I've moved on to Russia as well. So Putin's People is a book that I'm halfway through. It's about the KGB and Russia and earlier days of Putin, how he actually came about to be in power and stuff like that. In the current environment, that may be interesting.
I think we can take the last couple of questions. I will go with Devesh's question. What are your views on companies making a large number of acquisitions using the same for projecting even higher valuations? Also, the possibilities of mergers in these companies and how should we perceive these actions when companies are not even generating cash? I think you partly answered this one.
Yeah, serial acquirers should be looked at with suspicion. It's only when the first business that they started, if that is throwing out truckloads of cash, then you can use that cash to get into adjacencies or acquire companies and things like that. If you are yourself raising continuous money from VCs and in turn you are going on acquiring, then there's something funny going on.
So we can take one last question if anybody has, if you want to unmute yourself and ask. I think there seems to be no more questions left. I'll just stop the recording and stop the formal part of this presentation. And thanks, Rajeev, for a wonderful talk. And thanks for the wonderful questions from the audience. Thank you for attending.
Whenever things got rough, I always remember what my father used to say.
Running a business does test a man, my son. There are ups and downs. Glorious highs, and sometimes a low that leaves you feeling defeated.
The character of a man and the character of a business are not very different, are they?
Yes. But when the chips are down, we must stand up, dust ourselves off, and motor on.
Volatility. It's a funny thing. It makes you question yourself and wonder if you've made all the right decisions.
Sure, you can question some of your decisions, but stay steadfast on your goals.
Dad always said, there are no shortcuts and no quick profits.
There are no free lunches, are there? There is only one.
Right way.
At PPFAS, we think like Rahul and his father. That volatility is a fact of running a business. And buying equity shares is like owning a part of that business. We use value investing principles to manage your money. This means we invest in the right businesses at reasonable prices and for a longer term.
PPFAS Mutual Fund. There's only one right way. Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme related documents carefully.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.